What is good? I don't know what day it is. I think it's Tuesday. So happy Tuesday. Let's get to the case. Hola. What's up, Melissa? The case for today was an ultrasound. We haven't done too much ultrasound. So I wanted to start introducing some ultrasound cases. We've done a lot of X-ray. We've done a few CT. I'm slowly ramping up. As you can see, I start off with chest X-rays, did a little bit of abdominal X-rays, tossed in some CTs for some correlates. Ultrasound can be a completely different ball game. It's something that if you're not used to seeing, you have no idea what you're looking at. It's totally understandable. I was there at one point. But I'm going to start introducing more and more ultrasound cases so you guys can get familiar with it. Today, I posted this guy right here to begin with, and I said, what is this? So I got a couple of different answers in particular. One, a lot of people nailed it. This is a testicular ultrasound, and the hint that's why I gave was that it was a male patient. So it's a testicular ultrasound. The main things that you wanna look at on a testicular ultrasound, basically you're gonna have, in all ultrasound in general, you're gonna have a couple of different things that you're looking at. One is a grayscale image, which is basically just gray and white. That's all you see, little areas of black, that's it. Then you have a color Doppler image, which is what you're seeing here with all these little ditzels right here, and those are showing flow. So you have flow on there. Then you can have something called a duplex, and you're gonna see exactly which way the flow is going and the velocity of it. Those are the main things that you're looking at on ultrasound. For testicular ultrasound, it's really, really important to look at that grayscale. If you see grayscale that's heterogeneous, the testes, it doesn't look very homogeneous like it's supposed to. There's areas of dark, there's areas of bright. That's something to tip you off that something's abnormal. This grayscale, obviously this is color right here, but just take a look at the area right here. This is very homogeneous, it's good. I like it, everything looks pretty good to me, the grayscale image-wise. So that's the main thing that you look at and you say, okay, you know what, both are pretty good to go. What I call the money shot on these ultrasound exams is when they give you the left and right testicle side by side and they put a box around it and then it gives you color. That's what I put up originally for you guys. Yes, that's what I call the money shot. That's the image that you wanna look at that's gonna compare both sides. And that's what I kind of alluded to on one of my other questions is, which side is normal? Was the one side too hyperemic or was the other side not as hyperemic? So everybody actually guessed, for the most part, everyone said that yes, the second image that I posted, which was the epididymis. So the first image was the actual testicle side by side. Then the second image I posted were the epididymi from left and right. And most everybody said it was abnormal. But then I questioned you and I said, hey, which side is abnormal? Is one side just too bright or is the other side not as bright? And that has a significant, significant meaning. And that's the game that you play with testicular ultrasound. It is your job to figure out if one is too bright, if one has too much flow in it, or if the other one does not have as much flow in it. So the testicles on this case were actually okay. I did not have an issue with this image right here. This flow was symmetric pretty much bilaterally. I'm totally okay with that. The grayscale here, fine. The grayscale here, totally fine. Somebody may question this line right here that's completely normal on a testicular ultrasound. Bonus points for anybody who can tell me what this is called. Then I gave you this image right here. Now, those were the testes. These are the epididymi right here. The epididymis, it's labeled, it was all labeled for you too. This is right epididymis body, left epididymis body. So these are basically the things that are sitting, wrapping around the testicle. These can have issues as well. The same issues that you're basically looking at in the testicle, you can have here as well. Now, you're going to question, what are the main things that you're looking at in a testicle to figure out if something is abnormal? It's pretty much the same as a lot of other things that you're looking for. Number one, infection. Is it infected? You have a patient that's going to come into the ED and is going to be complaining of testicular pain. You don't really have a history. He may be, you know, saying some wishy-washy stuff. It's your job to figure out, well, okay, are we dealing with infection? Or number two, are we dealing with trauma? Is this thing torsed? Those are the main things in a testicle. Number three, a little less down on the list, but it does happen. Sorry about that. Okay, number three is you got to figure out malignancy. So you have the three main things that you're looking for. Now, which one, so we're going to play this thumbs up, thumbs down game, okay? For infection, do you think the vasculature is going to be thumbs up or thumbs down? Meaning, are you going to have increased vasculature or decreased vasculature? You got to figure that out. What happens in infection? Just reason it out. For all those pallor, whatever, I forgot the peas or the purulent, whatever it was, erythema, you know what I'm talking about for skin stuff, right? Everything becomes hyperemic. Everything becomes vasodilated. All the little mast cells, all the neutrophils, everything are going to go to that area. So when something is infected, it's going to recruit a lot of extra vasculature to try to help fight that infection by all the stuff in the bloodstream, right? So when you have something that's infected, exactly, you're going to have thumbs up, meaning you're going to have hyperemia. Okay, so infection, thumbs up. What happens if you have trauma and the guy has a torsed testicle? That's going to be thumbs down. You can imagine that. You have a vessel that's now occluded and it's going to twist on itself and it's going to take the outflow tract out. So you're going to have decreased flow in that testicle. So remember, rules of thumb. These are hardcore rules of thumb. For infection, thumbs up, hyperemia. For testicular torsion, thumbs down. It's bad. Torsion's bad. I don't know how you want to remember it. But my way of remembering it is anything in the body, when it's infected, it's going to have increased blood vasculature to that area because it wants to help fight that infection. So those are the two things that you're looking for in the testicle or testicular ultrasound. The case that I gave you, the testicles were normal. But then I gave you the epididymis. And the epididymis, now we're playing the thumbs up, thumbs down game just I had posted to you guys. Which one is this, thumbs up or is this thumbs down? That's for you guys to figure out. This is way too much flow in the right epididymis right here. This is way too much flow. There's all this flow. It's very hyperemic. This guy, this is about normal. This is the epididymal body right here, and you'll have an epididymal head as well, which is not imaged right here. But this epididymal body is normal vasculature. This is way too much. So now let's talk about terminology. You have an ascending infection that's going to go from urethra, prostate, wherever it's going, and then it's going to finally get towards the scrotum and start infecting that area. So how does it get to the testicle? Well, it goes through the epididymis. So yes, you can have isolated epididymitis. That makes sense, right? Then it's going to get to the testicle itself. Well, how did it get through the testicle? Like I literally just said, it's going to go through the epididymis. So you're going to have epididymal orchitis. That's when the epididymis and the testicle are inflamed together, epididymal orchitis. Somebody may ask me, hey, Amrit, can you get just isolated testicular inflammation and not the epididymis? The answer to that is yes, you can, but it is not as common. The main things, if you see isolated orchitis, you need to start thinking about some other things. Be very careful thinking about mumps maybe on the list. Some other viruses can cause that, like I think it's Coxsackie virus. So you need to start thinking outside of the box if you have just isolated orchitis. Mumps is the main one that I usually thinking about. So remember, just to recap real quick, epididymitis, then it's going to go and infect the testicle as well. So it's going to be epididymal orchitis. And then if it's just isolated orchitis, think about those very rare kind of things. So those are the main terminology things for that. We talked about infection versus torsion. What else do I want to talk about? Malignancy. That's obviously something that's on your mind if you have a testicular ultrasound. Malignancy, look at that grayscale image. Remember, go to the money shot. You want to see the left and right testicle side by side, and you want to see if one area is just very heterogeneous and the other one is not, and that's completely homogeneous. So if you have one that's completely off and it looks like a mass, and then you slap some color on there and there's some increased hyperemia, because remember, tumors for the most part will have increased vasculature. Yes, there are things that don't, but for the most part, if you have some weird vessels going into a circumscribed area, be very concerned for a mass. Some things that can hide in there, you have your germ cell tumors, your seminomas, non-seminomatous tumors, lymphoma. Remember, lymphoma can go to the testicles. Sarcoid, never rule out sarcoid. Yes, it can go there. One fun fact for maybe step one, but definitely for radiology boards, where are these tumors going to met to as far as lymphadenopathy? You're going to be looking for these retroperitoneal nodes. So if you're scrolling through a CT scan and you see these random juicy lymph nodes that are hugging the aorta and they're kind of in between the aorta and the IVC, be very concerned that there may be something going on down below. Yes, this happens in women as well, obviously not with the testicle, but when you have a gyne malignancy, it can go up through the retroperitoneal space and cause those nodes to get plumped up as well. What else? Hit the high notes. Do you biopsy a testicle if you're concerned about something? You do not. You don't biopsy the testicle. You basically get the imaging. You say, yeah, it's pretty much malignancy. And then the urologist will just take the testicle out. You don't biopsy that. Fun little fact. I got a funny story for you. I love telling this story. Now it's your turn to hear it. When I was a medicine intern, I hope somebody from medicine for my intern years listening right now. When I was a medicine intern, we were rounding in the ICU. We had a cirrhotic patient who had about 12 liters of fluid in his abdomen, and he was so edematous that it actually extended through into the scrotum as well. So he had a pretty large edematous scrotum. It was all full of ascites. And we're rounding, and I think the PD was with me as well, and there's a bunch of residents, interns, me, the prelim. I was in medicine prelim. I was like, I'm going into radiology, so I messed around a lot. And again, we're in the ICU. In the middle of rounds, I presented that ICU patient in the most serious voice that I could say. I was like, I think this patient is going to benefit from a parascrotocentesis. And I paused, as I tend to do. I got sometimes for me, the happiest I get is when I say a joke and nobody gets it for a good 20 seconds and I'm laughing out loud internally. I think I held it together for about 10 seconds and literally the residents thought I was like, that was a thing that they just didn't know was real. The attending pretty much reamed me out after that, but I cracked up from that. Now you know, I got some crazy stories from the ICU as an intern. What else can I answer? Oh, the last entity that you may need to think about when you're talking about, actually two more things that I want to touch on. Number one, you can have epididymitis like we talked about, epididymorchitis and orchitis. The other thing that I want to mention to you is something called funiculitis. This is not actually inflammation of the things that we just talked about, but that's inflammation of the spermatic cord itself. So do not, especially radiology residents who are reading testicular ultrasounds, don't just say epididymitis is ruled out, orchitis is ruled out, next. Look at the cord as well. If you see something that is big, juicy, a lot of hyperemia that's not in the epididymis or the testicle, and it's kind of up higher, think about funiculitis. That is a thing, absolutely. You can Google it if you want. I've had about 3 cases of it on call already. Last thing I wanted to talk about, varicoceles. This is a boards question. This is an anatomy question, med students, residents. You needed to know the anatomy. Where does your gonadal vein drain into on both sides? So if you think about it, which side is your IVC on? This is my right IJ. This is going to be, again, flipped in the screen, but this is my right IJ. And this goes straight down under the hemidiaphragm, straight down into the IVC. So my IVC is on this side, okay? So the gonadal vein on that side is going to drain right into the IVC. The gonadal vein on this side, though, the kidney's sitting way over here. It has to have a renal vein that wraps all the way across and hooks into the IVC. So the gonadal vein on this side is going to drain into that renal vein. So if you had an occlusion of this side right here, that's actually not too bad because it's a small gonadal vein going into a small renal vein. Yeah, that may just happen, right? That's not too bad. So if I see an isolated varicocele on the left side, that's probably fine. I'm okay with it. But if I have a if I have a gonadal vein going into the IVC on this side, that is a gonadal vein going into a massive vein. That's a pretty big vein. So if you have an isolated right-sided varicocele, you need to immediately recommend getting cross-sectional imaging because there may be some massive lymphadenopathy or some sort of mass in the retroperitoneal space that's causing occlusion on that side. Somebody may ask what a varicocele is. That's basically dilated vasculature down below. If anybody wants to know, there's rules of three when you're reading testicular ultrasounds. They have to be greater than 3 millimeters, and there have to be at least 3 imaged vessels that are greater than 3 millimeters in one cut, and that will be a varicocele. How can you, this is a fun little test, how can you elicit a varicocele or make it worse? You're gonna ask the patient to bear down, just like you do with other things that cause pressure in the, you know, inside the body. That's no different. You ask them to bear down, Valsalva, and it will accentuate that varicocele. All right, I just talked a lot. Who's got some questions? Somebody asked what technology is going to change radiology in the next 10 years. There's been talk about artificial intelligence for God knows how many years before when I started med school. They were talking about AI all the time. It's made some progress. It's not here yet. I would love to have AI. It can read all those chest x-rays and tell me it's negative, and then I'll just sign off on the report. I'm down. PET MRI, that's becoming a thing now. It's definitely been around. Hopefully that'll catch on and start doing some more cool stuff. MRI itself, 3T is the kind of the standard of care right now, 1.5T and 3T. 7T is out now for anybody who doesn't really care for the words that I'm saying right now. Sorry. But 7T is just really, really high definition. It's got a lot of other issues too. You can have a lot of artifact, but those are the main things right now that come off the top of my head. Who's got something else? We'll talk about, for recap, I want to start incorporating ultrasound some more. It's not something that's taught that or a lot. It's very confusing when you first start it. I want to go through the basics of, just liver. What am I looking at? Portal vein. What are the vessels that I'm looking at? What do vessels even look like on ultrasound? Real quick recap for anybody who hasn't seen the videos in the past. What are the three words that you're using for ultrasound to describe things? Hyperechoic, anechoic, or hypoechoic. I should have flipped those. Hyper, it's increased echogenicity. Hypo, it's decreased echogenicity. Anechoic is black. It's like simple fluid. It's a cyst, a simple, simple cyst. So those are just the quick terms to remember when talking about ultrasound. Any other questions? That was really helpful. Hey, I appreciate it. Fun too. Good. I'm glad I'm making it a little bit fun, right? Well, I'm always just chugging down water as you guys are listening to me ramble. All right, we good? I don't think these are posting anymore. I don't know what's going on with posting my lives to Instagram for 24 hours. They get all jacked up. I have no clue, but luckily I got that YouTube channel up and running. I'll just keep posting them on there. You guys check them out. Let other people know, please. I appreciate that. Any questions? Oh, about my post, my actual post, the case from this morning, osteosarcoma. Did you guys catch the little hints that I dropped in the radiograph description? I mentioned the, the sunburst appearance, a periosteal reaction. That was all osteosarcoma. Any questions about that? Let's see. It would be great to hear some tips on how to utilize ultrasound imaging in the ICU for medicine residents. Absolutely. I'm glad you mentioned that. I will do a dedicated session on that. Ultrasound is so effective in the ICU. I did that as an intern. We relied on ultrasound so much. Anything from a paracentesis, a thoracentesis, to even check if there's a pneumothorax. I'm not getting a chest x-ray. I'm going to slap an ultrasound on the patient's chest, and I'm going to see if there's a pneumothorax. I'll tell you how to do that later. Echocardiography, sitting in the ICU, just putting an ultrasound on the patient's chest, take a look at what's happening. If you can tell if there's a pericardial effusion, and you can tell if there's a tamponade physiology from it too. What else? There's so much to do with ultrasound. If you're not utilizing ultrasound at your institution, you are slacking. I'm not lying. Just go. I mentioned this to a lot of med students and a lot of interns. if you are bored and you have nothing to do, go to an ICU patient that's sedated or somebody who just doesn't mind and just say, hey, do you mind if I just put an ultrasound on you and just figure out what's going on? Patients don't care. For the most part, I'm telling you, you will learn so much. Take a look at the IJ and then the carotid. Know the difference, what they're supposed to look like and what they're not supposed to look like. Imagine your needle going into the IJ when you're doing a central line. It makes a world of a difference. Take a look at the groin. Take a look at the femoral vein versus the femoral artery. Start doing these things. Be proactive. Seriously, that's what I did as a med student. As an intern, I didn't just sit around and wait for something to happen. Be proactive. Get out there. Patients don't mind. Your residents don't mind. Your attendings don't mind. Shoot, if a med student asked me to do something right now or whatever, if you're rounding with me, by the way, ever on IR, if you're a med student with me, if I'm about to go do a paracentesis, I don't want to do it. I don't care to do a paracentesis. You come with me. You get your hands dirty. Be proactive. I'm telling you guys. All right, I think that's it for today. I'll see what the case is for tomorrow. Good session today. We'll do some more ultrasound in a bit, but I appreciate you guys as always. Later.